Good afternoon, and welcome to Left Brain Books. Thank you for joining us on this very brisk afternoon. And thank you so much for your patience. I know we're starting a little later.
Left Bank Books has been around for a very long time. We've been part of the St. Louis literary community for over 40 years, and we couldn't have done it without all of you, all of your support, and we do very much thank you. If you have any questions, if you need to use the restroom, if Spike the Cat bothers you, or you want to know where he is, let me know. My name is Erin. Also, Cliff and Mark behind the counter. We'd be happy to help you in whatever way that we can. So with the events in Ferguson and the ongoing crises around the world, turning ourselves towards revolutionary thinking may prove to be exactly what our community needs. Here to redefine and reroute our notions of communism, socialism, and capitalism is political science professor Dr. Richard Gilman-Opalsky. He is the author of Precarious Communism, Manifest Mutations, Manifesto Detournement. And we are very pleased to host Dr. Gilman-Opalsky, as we are pleased to host a variety of authors. An exhaustive list can be found at our website, left-bank.com. But there are a couple upcoming events, if you don't mind, I'd just like to share them with you. On April 15th, that's a Wednesday, 7 p.m., Benjamin Percy will be speaking about his new novel, The Deadlands. It's going to be down the street at the Improv Shop. And this novel is a retelling of Lewis and Clark's travels from St. Louis to Oregon. And it takes place 150 years in the future, and there's been an environmental catastrophe. So it's a retelling of the adventure, but it's quite a book. And more importantly, on Sunday, April 19th, we have Roxanne Dunbar-Ortiz. She's not only a radical woman, she's also just a plain old, good old-fashioned radical. And she will be here promoting her book, Indigenous Peoples: History of the United States. And I don't think I need to say much more than that. Beyond, there's not much out there talking about Indigenous rights and Indigenous history. So that's April 19th, Sunday, 3 p.m. here where you're sitting. And we hope that you will join us. So enough with the future. Let's talk about today. Dr. Richard Gilman-Opalsky earned his PhD in political science at the New School for Social Research in 2006. His teaching and research focuses on the history of political philosophy, continental and contemporary social theory, Marxism, capitalism, autonomous politics, postmodern philosophy, critical theory, social movements, and the public sphere. Dr. Gilman-Opalsky is the author of three books: Unbound Publics, Transgressive Public Spheres, Zapatismo, and Political Theory, that was published in 2008, Spectacular Capitalism, Guy Debord and the Practice of Radical Philosophy, published in 2011, and Precarious Communism, Manifest Mutations, Manifesto Detournement, published in 2014. Spectacular Capitalism was selected as the Book of the Month by the International Herbert Marcuse Society. He has published numerous articles on social theory and political philosophy, specializing on theories of revolution, contentious politics, philosophy of praxis, and capitalism and its culture. We do have both Precarious Communism and Spectacular Capitalism on sale at the front counter. We would very much appreciate if you purchase a copy, and I believe that Richard will be signing after he speaks. So without further ado, please give a very warm welcome to Dr. Richard Gilman-Opalsky.
I will thank you for coming to spend your Sunday afternoon here talking about philosophy and communism and the Ferguson Uprising and other things. I really do appreciate that. If you don't have either Precarious Communism or Spectacular Capitalism, I would strongly encourage you, if you're interested, to buy it here. As Erin said, the bookstore has been around since 1969, and it's a really remarkable feat. So if you don't want to buy those books, maybe you should buy another book here before you leave this evening. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to give a kind of constellation talk where I talk about a bunch of things that are related to both Precarious Communism and to the Ferguson Uprising. This book was released, Precarious Communism, in the North American book trade in August of 2014, the same month that things broke out in Ferguson. And had I been delayed at all, I would have included some discussion of Ferguson in this book, as I did include discussion of uprisings up to that point, recent uprisings up to that point. The book, Precarious Communism, was for me the fulfillment of an interest that I had in just engaging a very close study of Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels' Communist Manifesto of 1848. Whether one agrees or not with the arguments in that book, it is a really beautiful text. And I wanted to go deep into it and read every line and think about it in light of over 160 years of history, as much as a person of my limited capabilities could do. So it is a book-length study of another book. That's one thing that Precarious Communism is. Of interest is also the method that I used to write the book. Maybe it's of interest to some of you. And I used a method called detournement, which I adapted from artists and activists who use this method of detournement, which means a rerouting, a hijacking, or a repurposing of some source material. Detournement, the word, means rerouting, hijacking, or repurposing of some source material. So I did a detournement on the Manifesto of 1848, which means that I read each sentence and rethought it in light of current events. And also, one of the reasons for doing that was to read the book from within, that my book follows the form and the thematic content of the original Manifesto of 1848, but tries to reveal some of the deficits or shortcomings of the original manifesto, but also tries to show its enduring relevance and its ongoing applicability to what is happening in the world now. Something about the word precarious and the title. The word precarious means a kind of uncertainty, and precarity or precariousness indicates more specifically an uncertain future. Okay. And in Europe, over the last, 10, 12 years, in a lot of the political conversations, people have stopped using the word proletariat and increasingly been using the word precariat. So proletariat, in Marx's language, referring to the industrial working class, people who work in the factories after 100 years of industrial revolution, was seen not really to describe the position of impoverished workers as well today as it did 160 years ago. And so there's been a kind of slow, it's much slower in North America, the adoption of this term precariat, but it is making its way here as well. And it basically means people with uncertain futures, people who cannot count, as perhaps previous generations might have been able to, on 30 or 40 years at a particular firm or company with something like a pension or some kind of a retirement or social security. And increasingly precarious people also goes across class lines, so that it's not only the kind of industrial working class who are increasingly precarious. Now, if you look at the title of the book, Precarious Communism, very literally it means a kind of uncertain communism, a communism that wants to assert itself but can only do so in a context of uncertainty, a communism with an uncertain future, a communism with an uncertain future. And so what I want to argue for in this book is a communism, but a communism that is self-consciously aware of the failures and deficits of earlier efforts, especially from the 20th century. So in the book, I say, largely, precarious communism describes the already existing position of communists today, whose communism is neither well characterized by confidence nor by nihilism. What it means to be a precarious communist is to be as much as possible a non-ideological communist who is honest about the past, present, and future. I think today, if you meet communists who are very confident that they know exactly how things ought to go and that it's their party that you should sign up for and that the other vanguards aren't the real one, these are communists you should be afraid of. That overly confident communists, I think, are a thing, if they aren't already, they should be a thing of a past. And as much as they aren't an endangered species, this is bad news. But I also think that people aren't, that communists in the 21st century are not nihilists. They are not defeatists. They are just unsure. They don't have some kind of certainty in the dialectic of history to bring out some great resolution to an ultimate crisis. So why even speak of precarious communism? Well, precarious communism is precarious inasmuch as it accepts that concrete proposals for new ways of being in the world will be differentially developed as nodal points within the context of actually existing revolt. What does that mean? That means that the precarious communists, we look out and we see uprisings, demands for dignity, challenges to the existing state of affairs as possible and hopeful moments that challenge what is in the interest of what ought to be. We look out and we see uprisings, challenges, revolts, riots, social movements, and even those that fail or that burn out, that rise and dissipate like a Saturnalia. We find in them a possible precarious hope. A possible and precarious hope. But why speak of communism? Because precarious communists, although they are uncertain about so much, have one single confident claim, and that is that a world organized by the logic of capital is a world organized against the diverse interests of most people on Earth. And where do you get such a radical idea, such a crazy notion, such a radical notion from groups like Oxfam and the Economic Policy Institute, from very conservative sources, including you've seen probably how the Paris School of Economics has been compiling in Thomas Piketty's book, Capital in the 21st Century, data that goes into an always growing record that shows that the logic of capital is working out for a very small number of people and increasingly small all the time. Okay, and we could, if you find this to be controversial, I'd be happy to discuss it further. But here I'm doing no more than taking sides with the most conservative macroeconomic data that essentially nobody disagrees with. Okay, that's not supposed to be preemptive, it's just what it is. So what are precarious communists doing? What are their aims? Well, there is no one immediate aim of precarious communists. And there is a general loss of faith in the conquest of political power. Sometimes you find in some of these Occupy movements and in Turkey and in Gezi Park, in Taksim Square, in Tahrir Square, you find a heavy presence of communist parties. But the energy there largely exceeds the limitations of those party proposals. It's not to say that it doesn't at all come from them or sync up with that energy, because it does. But there is a general disaffection. I would even call it a communist disaffection. There is a widespread communist disaffection with communist parties and communist projects. And this largely comes from a slow and painful looking back on the problems of the previous century. But everywhere, and in any creative manner, precarious communists critically observe, represent, and try to exacerbate the breaking apart of the ideological and material bases of the existing society and its operational logic. So we are participating in all form of critique of questioning the superiority and the sustainability of the logic of the world. Okay, and I want to just here give you a sense of how did Marx define communism himself in 1845. In 1845, Karl Marx defined communism in the German ideology as a process that abolishes the present state of things. And he says in the same passage that it is not, we call communism no stable state, no ideal state, no end state. It is a process which abolishes the present state of things. Those are Marx's words in 1845. So communism is a process of confronting the existing state of affairs, challenging it, and trying to overturn it and replace it with a new one based on a different logic. Now, here I see a kind of relationship to philosophy and a relationship to revolt that I'd like to apply to some thinking about Ferguson. So I'm going to move a little bit across some sort of uneven terrain, but mostly for the sake of just giving us a bunch of different things to think about, okay? The theoretical positions of precarious communists are in no way based on ideas or principles that have been invented or discovered by some professional philosopher. Philosophy is often done better by events. Now, this basic claim that philosophy is often done better by events has become the centerpiece of my latest research. And let me say a little bit. I'll say a little bit more about it. Sometimes a revolt, sometimes what is called a riot, is a work of philosophy in a very classical sense. A riot or a revolt can be a philosophical movement, a philosophical modality. What does it mean? Because a riot or a revolt, like a philosophical text, raises penetrating questions about the world in which it occurs. It happens within that world and yet throws it into question in various ways. Ways without answers. It raises more questions than it does answers, much like philosophy does. Good philosophy has always thrown the world as we knew it into question. And sometimes social movements accomplish that goal better than books. I dare say that most authors wish they have a secret, if not open, aspiration that what they write might be as provocative as what happened in Ferguson in August of last year. That it would raise so many questions, that it would participate in so many discussions, and that it would challenge so many people to think and to rethink what they take for granted. Philosophy is a desperate act, and it mostly fails. Uncertainty has long been the oxygen of philosophy, going all the way back to Socrates. People used to stop Socrates in the streets and beg him to answer questions, and he used to say, "I don't know." And then you'd have something like the Republic. He was just on his way home, and then 400 pages later, you know, he's still trying to figure out what is justice. It's a lot of uncertainty. Philosophy goes where there is uncertainty, and when you collect a lot of certain facts in a line of inquiry, it breaks off from philosophy. It becomes another field, a subfield, like sociology or psychology. The first book of physics was written by Aristotle, right? Adam Smith didn't think that he was writing economics. When he wrote The Wealth of Nations, he was writing moral philosophy. The book he wrote before it was called The Theory of Moral Sentiments. He didn't think that he was writing economics. But after a long time, you have the establishment of some certitude. It breaks itself out from philosophy and becomes another field, another discipline that claims knowledge. Philosophy functions where there is less certainty, less knowledge. That's where philosophy goes. So philosophy is a precarious thing. It functions on uncertainty. Philosophy is it works where there is uncertainty, where there is, as philosophers would say, epistemological or ontological uncertainty, where we don't know what we are, how things are, or even what we know. Uncertainty gives philosophy what it needs to breathe. To be precarious is to have more questions than answered and to be unsettled by uncertainty. And this is also the disposition of philosophy. So, what does this have to do with revolt? What does this have to do with Ferguson? Why did I want to call this talk Precarious Communism and the Ferguson Uprising? Well, revolt includes some form of social upheaval, some uprising. revolt is a politics by other means than conventional procedures. Where revolt happens, it is largely motivated by frustrations with failures of reform, or by a lack of faith in legal and electoral channels. People who are satisfied with legal and electoral channels are the last in line to participate in a revolt. Revolt comes out of frustration. Revolt sometimes includes challenges to existing law. Sometimes it even wants to change laws or is responding to laws that it thinks unjust. In this way, revolt might even be reformist. Sometimes, though, revolt includes what we call insurrections or riots. Sometimes revolt does include revolutionary aspirations, but not always. Not every revolt wants revolution. Given the reality of growing inequality and diminishing opportunity, the absence of revolt may be harder to explain than its presence. There is, of course, a tendency whenever there is an uprising like that in Ferguson to try to understand why did that happen, what caused it. So I think that we might better ask why isn't it happening when it isn't happening. Take something like in the Egyptian case. It's not that, for example, Mubarak did something that he hadn't already been doing for 3 decades. So sometimes the more interesting question is why isn't revolt happening, not why is it happening. The great philosopher of revolt, Julia Kristeva, I don't know if her books are here in the store, but if they are, maybe you can get one of those instead of one of mine. Hers are better. The great philosopher of revolt, Julia Kristeva, claims that, quoting her, revolt refers to a state of permanent questioning, of transformation, of change, an endless probing of appearances. That's how Kristeva, who wrote 3 books, which I think of a kind of trilogy on revolt. One is called Intimate Revolt. The other one is called Revolution in Poetic Language. And the other one is called The Sense and Nonsense of Revolt. And this is how she defines revolt, as a permanent questioning, a probing of appearances. In light of these terms of permanent questioning and probing appearances, I think of revolt as a kind of philosopher, because after all, the best philosophers, this is what they do. They go into a state of questioning and a probing of appearances. The role of the philosopher is to critically interrogate what is in consideration of what could be and should be. So revolt, at its best, does what good philosophy has always done. It wants to throw the reality and the justice of the world into question. It expresses disaffections. It reveals problems. But much like philosophy, revolt is not in and of itself a solution to the problem. Sometimes people say, as someone who teaches philosophy, I can tell you that one of the most common questions is, how does this solve a problem? And students who don't like being in the class, they say, I can't see how this immediately solves a problem, and so therefore, why should I be here? In a similar way, revolt and philosophy, they share that they are not solutions to problems directly, but they conceive of themselves, I say both philosophy and revolt, as part of resolutions, as thinking critically about the logic of things, thinking critically about the reality and justice of things, as philosophers do, questioning and challenging them as happens in revolts. These may not be solutions in and of themselves, but they happen because those who make them, revolts and philosophies, see themselves as participating in resolutions, if not now, at least on the horizon. And why do I say this? Because I'm interested in defending philosophy and raising philosophy up? It's exactly the opposite. I say this because I'm interested in raising up revolt to a status worthy of its dignity. For example, revolt, and especially what is called seemingly spontaneous revolt, seemingly spontaneous uprisings that appear to come out of nowhere, they are typically characterized as the opposite of thinking, as emotional outbursts that are destructive and always condemnably violent. So my interest in relating revolt and philosophy comes from an interest in coming to the rescue of understanding what revolt is about, what is happening there. There is a long history of people in positions of power calling all those who oppose them irrational. And if you've noticed, whenever there is any kind of uprising, certainly the one in Ferguson is as good an example of any. Watch how it is framed, discussed, and taken up in the main as an irrational, violent, over-the-top, emotional outburst that can't possibly be reasonable because it's too subjective. It doesn't have the traits of objectivity and reason. Well, there's a long history of people who call those, oppose them irrational. This was best studied by Michel Foucault, perhaps, who wrote a book called Madness and Civilization, A History of Insanity in the Age of Reason, where Foucault is really interested in understanding what gets called insane, what gets called irrational. But there is also a history of challenging that perspective. The perspective that says that reason looks this way. It looks like respectable men in universities who are professional thinkers. In fact, one of the earliest challenges to that view comes from Socrates himself. Socrates, who hated what he called the sophists, those professional intellectuals who sold their skills to the sons of rich families so that they could rise up in politics. The sophists were the class of people, if you had enough money, you could hire them in ancient Greek politics to train your kids in the art of argumentation so that they could win arguments enough to win elections. Socrates despised them. He tried to show that slaves could think. He tried to show that in a dialogue of Plato's called the Meno, that Meno's slave was capable of doing philosophy. And of course, Socrates, iconic philosopher of philosophers, was at the same time an enemy of the state. He was an enemy of the state, and he was put to death for doing philosophy in the streets. That is the fate of Socrates as we know it. That for doing philosophy in the streets, for raising questions about the justice and reality of Athens in his time, he was an enemy of the state, and he was put to death for it. So in many ways, when I think of revolt, I'm interested in asking an old question. Who else does philosophy in the streets? Is there anyone else besides Socrates who has been doing philosophy in the streets? And this brings us to the case of the uprising surrounding the police shooting and killing of Michael Brown in Ferguson, August 2014. As you know, Ferguson was rocked for days by all kinds of uprising, including peaceful protests, of course, but also including smashed shop windows, fires, confrontations with police, looting by people with indignation. While news reports openly and reliably condemned these uprisings, never hesitating to condemn their violence, some participants in the upheaval explained their rationality, explained their reason, explained their logic. One participant in the rioting, DeAndre Smith, told the St. Louis Post-Dispatch that the Ferguson revolt was exactly the right response to the injustice, saying, quoting DeAndre Smith, "I think they got a taste of what fighting back means." Now, it's obvious that any honest consideration of the Ferguson uprisings is going to require a confrontation with questions of racism, power, poverty, justice, and police brutality. That doesn't mean that everybody who talks about what happened in Ferguson will take the same position on those subjects, but anybody who talks about Ferguson beyond the flat platitudinal condemnation of its so-called violence is going to talk about those things. Even if we have disagreements, we will talk about race, we will talk about police brutality, we will talk about poverty. Those are just some of the issues, among others, that a dedicated reading of Revolt might explore. We also shouldn't lose sight of the fact that the revolt is itself the catalyst. It's the agenda-setting event. I mean, sometimes I want this, like many other people, I'm not very uncommon. What I'm doing is in some ways very usual in the academy. We want to talk about these things, but we can't do it. We can't do it until something happens in the society that makes it possible for us to talk about these things. I can remember feeling very grateful years ago for the Occupy events because it made it possible for me to have conversations with other people outside of my class on Marx about capitalism. because people were having that conversation, and because Occupy did a far better job than any book can do or hope to do at putting it on the agenda. All of the follow-up analysis about economic crisis, the opportunity structure in impoverished black communities, about tactics, about rebellion, about the historical context of violence in America, emerges from a former previous communique, the communique of revolt. Before this event was scheduled, I'm doing some work now on a project I'm tentatively calling Specters of Revolt, where I'm looking at revolt more in a more dedicated way. I was looking at this bookstore because I saw the Ferguson Reads, where people were coming to talk about Ferguson in the context of different kinds of analysis. I don't know if any of the folks here who I don't know have participated in those Ferguson Reads meetings. Are they still ongoing? And they're still ongoing. But what makes these kinds of collective inquiries possible, what sets the stage for them, what makes the invitation for people to come into a bookstore and to talk about these things, is the revolt. Now, what else matters here? Over a dozen teenagers have been killed by police since the Michael Brown shooting. Elsewhere, I have their names, but I would need the, I didn't have, bring them written down. Without having them written down, I can't tell you their names. I can tell you a few. But what's the difference that makes the difference? The difference that makes the difference between the cases we know about and the ones we don't know about is revolt. So I think it's clear that revolt participates in the proliferation and production of critique, inquiry, and understanding. Now, on a bigger picture, these are more just kind of practical things about revolt, the kinds of conversations that it initiates, the kinds of questions it asks. But on a bigger picture, and I think a more interesting one, revolts are made by those who want to live in a different world. Revolts are made by people who want to live in a different world, but who don't share a single blueprint for that different world, and who honestly don't know how to make one. Revolts, there's always somebody in an uprising who says they know exactly what must be done. It's just that the person standing next to them doesn't agree. So revolt as a collective activity, as a collective action, is a precarious politics of world making. It is a kind of uncertain endeavor. It is an effort. They know that the existing state of affairs is to be challenged, is to be confronted, but they don't know exactly what would be the alternative world. And they don't share, even if some do, there are rival visions. So in revolt, the only great confidence is that the present state of affairs is unacceptable. And so some people think, especially political scientists who are, I think, embarrassingly, in a way, my people, they think that this signals failure. If there isn't some kind of a cohesive agenda or solution that comes out of revolt, it must be failure. But I think what gets lost in that reading is the fact that we are used to accepting the unacceptable. We are used to tolerating the intolerable. And that in between every revolt, that is largely what we do. That's largely what happens in societies. We accept the unacceptable. We tolerate the intolerable. And revolt breaks that pathological obedience. And I think it's fundamentally about human dignity. In Ferguson, the word dignity was often invoked. So I'd like now just to jump to a brief discussion of dignity from the book, and then in conclusion to relate that to dignity in revolt in Ferguson, or the dignity of the Ferguson revolt. Dignity. In thinking about precarious communism, there are a number of principles that I put forward in my book as key defining principles for a precarious communism, for a communism that wants to be but doesn't know exactly how to be. And one of those three principles is dignity. Is there a person anywhere who does not want dignity? We are suspicious of universal principles, and we know that dignity may be defined differently by different people. But what is dignity? The word and concept have problematic moorings, encrusted from the 13th century with connections to privilege, nobility, and social rank. But its more general conceptualization includes notions of worthiness, fitness, recognition, and respect. A human person wants her worth to be recognized, wants what she does to be properly appreciated by others, wants to do what she feels most fit to do. And this whole constellation of things necessary for human dignity depends upon self-respect. So here I'm just thinking about what is dignity. If a person has little or no self-respect, then she cannot feel her worth. She will not trust the affirmative recognition of others. She will not understand what she is fit to do, and she may not know how to distinguish practical necessity from actual desire, which means that a person who doesn't know themselves may not know how to differentiate between what she needs to do and what she wants to do. And in our society, a lot of times there's a conflation between those things. We do what we have to do, to the point where it's almost a strange question, why aren't you doing what you desire to do? Obviously, why would you ask me? Because I have to do what I'm doing. If a person doesn't feel that they have their dignity, no one can tell them otherwise. Dignity is a strange kind of property. Whether or not one has their dignity can only be assessed on an affective level. This means on the level of feeling. Whether or not a person has this thing called dignity can only be discovered if we ask them if they feel dignified. The Mexican government could not tell the Mayan population of Chiapas in the mid-1990s that they were being well-respected, treated in accordance with their worth. When white U.S. football fans insist that their Native American team mascots are meant to dignify and not to degrade, their claim is totally irrelevant. What matters is only the extent to which Native Americans feel dignified or not by the icons. If the housewife is reassured by her husband that she is doing what she is most fit to do and is duly appreciated, rewarded, and recognized, one question remains. How does she feel about it? The Chick-fil-A restaurant chain cannot claim that they are all for the dignity of homosexuals while publicly expressing their confident belief, for them grounded in the Bible, that gays and lesbians are destined for the lake of fire. So, of course, what Chick-fil-A says is, we look at you with all dignity, but of course you will be in the lake of fire. If human dignity means anything to you, then you cannot defer the question to those who are in the position of reassuring the ones they've offended that they shouldn't be offended. So dignity is this strange property. It's an affective property. If people feel indignity, then they don't have dignity. Now, Marx had a strong understanding of the importance of dignity, which he articulated early on, the age of 26, in his manuscripts of 1844. Marx wrote, quote, "A forcing up of wages would therefore be nothing but better payment for the slave, and would not conquer either for the worker or for labor their human status and dignity," close quotes. What Marx meant by this is that wherever the content of a person's everyday life is felt to be undignified, raising wages may be welcome for practical purposes, but it won't solve the problem of dignity. So if a person feels indignity at work, of course they might want to raise in wages, but if what they are doing, if the nature of what they are doing doesn't make them feel dignified, they don't have dignity. And one of the reasons I'm so interested in the concept of dignity, it is something that cannot be secured in capitalist exchange relations. One of the other parts where Marx talks about this, he talks about prostitution. That if a woman feels degraded doing sex work, that raising fees for a sex act is not going to solve the problem of her dignity. It may solve other problems, but not the problem of dignity. The dignity is this strange property that cannot be secured through capitalist exchange relations. Now, shortly after this book was published, the same idea was expressed in Ferguson, Missouri. Talk about dignity and indignity defines so much of the first-hand reportage that comes out of the streets. One participant in the uprising said, quote, "Mike Brown sparked a universal moment of clarity for young black people. We feel as if no one in a position of power respects us. We feel as if we are not viewed as humans." Close quotes. Notice the language. Think about the language. Would it be enough if people in positions of power, a mayor, a legislator, a police chief, says, no, we respect you. No, we view you as fully human. It doesn't solve the problem of dignity, because dignity is an affective property. You can't just tell someone that they have it. To conclude, just the last paragraph from the book. And actually, in the last part of the book, I'm thinking about revolt. I'm thinking about, just as was Marx, in the final sections of the Manifesto of 1848, following the format and the project of this book, I too followed and wanted to think about those same subjects. So some of you who've read that book may notice some of the similarities in the ideas. To unwind does not always mean to breathe deeply, to meditate, to adapt, and to peaceably accept the world as it is. To unwind. Sometimes, for example, a riot is a means of psychic revolt against the tightly wound compression of everyday life, against racial profiling and police repression, against the generalized anxiety and repression of society and economy. To unwind is even a common way to speak of the healthy response to work and its problems. You know, when you come home from work sometimes, after a hard day, a long day, you might say to your family, a loved one, "I just will need to unwind." Sometimes I come home and my son wants to jump on top of my head, and I say, "Give me a minute before you do that. I need to unwind. Then you can jump on top of my head." To unwind is a common way to speak of the response to work and its problems, where we imagine unwinding as a kind of precarious liberation from tension, a decompression, a momentary freedom, a becoming disentangled, at least until we're rewound once again. Sometimes to unwind is just to have some temporary reprieve from being wound again for the next day's work. Yet, to unwind is also to cause an uncoiling, to literally undo what has been held in place under pressure by the demands of making a living, by fears of dislocation, by the brutal logic of capital. At their best, the unwound are unruly, unpredictable, and ecstatic, giving up a pent-up energy held in for too long. Worried of the world, unwind. Thanks. Thank you. I would be happy to talk about any of those ideas in any direction you might like. A bit of a scatter shot, but the things are connected and can be. We can work on that if you want for a bit.
I'm really interested in your discussion on dignity, and specifically its affective qualities. And I wonder about how one feels that dignity initially, if you are living in a society that conditions you to have sort of unacceptable expectations. If that makes sense, right? So like living in a society where you're treated as a second class citizen, but you don't understand that there are these different classes of sort of or ways of life.
Can you say that again?
If you've been conditioned from the beginning to not have dignity at all.
Right. Yeah, you know, dignity is something that I'm really only just beginning to think about. It's such an interesting
idea for me in a number of ways. First of all, I read a lot of postmodern theory and philosophy in which there's almost no trust at all for anything approaching a universal concept. That anything that appears to have universality doesn't. And so, of course, the inclination then is to try to think of something that has some universality. Like, is there an idea, a notion, a thing that seems to have a kind of universal affirmation? And dignity, I don't know that that's the answer. But it appears to me to be a concept where nobody doesn't want it. Nobody doesn't want it. Now, in different locations, in different contexts, people will define it differently, and maybe in ways that we would want to reject. Oh, no, that's not dignity. You mean that life you're living, which you would defend as dignified? If you only saw or had the experience of this other way of doing things, you might then see that it's not dignified at all. Perhaps we would argue about what is and is not dignified, is what I mean by that. Nonetheless, it appears to me an idea that nobody anywhere would reject, that people want it. And so this leads me to question, why would people want it? And what is it that they want? Dignity is a really interesting philosophical concept because it is a concept with content, but its content differs from person to person and place to place. So what I tried to do, and I read through it very quickly, and I'm sorry to say that that's how, I mean, I don't want to, you know, go on too long already, seems to have some things in common, some sense of worthiness and respect and fittingness, that one is doing what one is fit to do and is recognized as such. I think it implicates some concept of recognition. So if you don't have dignity, I think you know it. It's a kind of deprivation. Some deprivations we know in a physiological sense, right? If you're hungry, you know it. If you're thirsty, you know it. If you're parched, if you're hot, if you're cold, you know it. It seems to me that dignity is something we also know when we are deprived of it, but rather than a base physiological property, it's an affective property. So sometimes, for example, when a person is very healthy, like I am right now, feeling very healthy, you can hardly recognize that status of being healthy until, like tomorrow, you fall sick. And then all of a sudden, it brings into stark relief. Everybody has had this experience. When you're coughing and you're tired and your head hurts, that you are now deprived of something that you took for granted, having at all. Because when I'm in a healthy state, I never think about the state of being healthy. The only time I ever think about the state of being healthy is when I'm deprived of my good health. So I see dignity as some kind of, and I know this is very vague still, but I see dignity as some kind of affective property that people know when they have it and know when they don't. And I think even at the level of childhood, this can be seen. So sometimes I watch my own young children and how, you know, how feeling misrecognized or misunderstood, especially by a parent. There's a certain indignity in that that's almost impossible to justify. Anyone who has parents knows it. It's something like, how could you think that about me, of all people? Because there is an expectation of recognition there. And it seems to me, in relation to revolt, that revolt is a social phenomenon which occurs out of what is called indignation, a condition of being being deprived of dignity. It is that revolt is an expression of indignation. And it seems to me that when we look at revolts historically, in one of my books, Unbounded Publics, I look at the case of the Zapatistas, which I mentioned in passing tonight, in Mexico in 1994. The position of the indigenous population of Chiapas, which, you know, Dunbar orbits also, she looks at this kind of thing too, is a position of indignity and a demand for dignity. And governments will say, no, you have our respect, but it doesn't work. So this is what I'm trying to think through there. And I think, too, in Ferguson, this is a problem of indignation, among other things. Among other things.
So dignity and indignation seem to me aren't just affective qualities, but are very bodily qualities that have a sort of material element or a physical element. So I think of the ways that indignation is staved off with, like, pharmaceuticals or something like that. You know, you don't feel depressed because you're on an antidepressant or something like that. Like that, there's a bodily quality to indignation as well, and not just affective. Do you think that? I guess, does that factor into the way that you think about indignation?
Definitely. I think the body is of central importance to the whole discussion that I would want to have from start to finish, about precarious communism, about capital, about revolt, about philosophy, the whole thing, about dignity. The body is central. So how so? I mean, first of all, feelings are a problem for a lot of people and have to be dealt with in bodily ways. This is largely what the field of psychiatry addresses, is how do we, and you know, in the Communist Manifesto, there's a section called bourgeoisie and proletariat. My section is called the more and the less anxious, because the way I see the bourgeoisie and the proletariat in the context of precarity and precariousness is that you have more and less anxious people in the world. And the more capital a person has and the greater material security and comfort they have, the less anxious they are about a lot of things. But those people can also form very long lines out of a high-priced psychotherapist's office for other reasons. So anxiety is a kind of is a problem that cuts across class lines, and it is a bodily problem because that's the location at which it's treated, let's say medically or clinically. Okay. Also, feeling I don't think is somehow an affect in my own view, which I don't think is controversial at all. I think it's pretty much a consensus. Is that feeling is not somehow non-bodily in some Cartesian way, like the mind versus the body. I accept what is now an old view that the mind is bodily. You know, I don't believe in some metaphysical Cartesian idea that how you feel is somehow like non-material or immaterial. It is a part of the human person's body. It's a part of how you think and how you're situated in the world with other people. The other reason why I think bodies matter is because when people lack dignity or feel that they are deprived of dignity, that can be a very private affair. A lot of us deal with indignity in exactly that way. A facade makes it invisible. If I feel disrespected at work, I don't always want to show that. So I use the apparatus of the body to hide the indignity. If I feel disrespected anywhere, I might use the apparatus of the body to conceal the indignity. But what about the expression of indignation? Revolt takes bodies. That was a metaphysical thing there. There's the book flying out with no body around. But I think revolt takes bodies. And revolt is a collective bodily expression of disaffection, isn't it? So when large numbers of people come together in a city like Ferguson, before or after the Department of Justice makes its assessment, the expression of indignation about the killing or about the DOJ's analysis is dependent upon a collectivity of bodies in a physical space. So even if it comes from feeling, like the person I quoted, Tef Poe, says, we don't feel that we are respected. We don't feel this way. Affect can be a privatized thing. Part of my general view as a precarious communist is that there's too much privatization. Privatization not just in an economic sense, but privatization of social life. And so when we feel undignified, we should notice that so too do other people, and maybe we can express that indignity together. It seems to me that revolt always does that, a collective expression of indignity. It takes bodies.
Part of the dignity is being respected, but are those two concepts equivalent, or how does dignity go beyond or differ from being respected?
That's a really good question, and I don't know that I have really a better answer than any of you would on that, but I think of it this way, that maybe this isn't exactly right, but this is what I would say, is that it seems to me that dignity presupposes respect. But so respect is what we might call a prerequisite for dignity. It's a prerequisite for dignity. But having, for example, self-respect doesn't mean that you will be dignified because other people may not treat you as such. So I can have a lot of self-respect, but if I walk into a room and people don't have any respect for me, there can still be a situation of indignity with respect. So there has to be some kind of mutual respect. There also has to be some sense of one that one is doing what they desire to do. I think it includes other feelings than respect, than being respected or being respectful. So let's say you are a good worker on a job, and you respect the work that you do, and the other people who work with you have respect for you, but you feel that you really shouldn't be doing that at all because it has nothing to do with who you are as a person. Let's say a very good waiter across the street at Pi. I mean, that mutuality of respect, self-respect and the respect of others in the restaurant, may not make that into a dignified position or a dignified everyday life. If one feels that it's not what they ought to be doing, that it's not befitting who they are as a person. So I wouldn't want to say, for example, that people in a revolt have no self-respect. This is one of the reasons why I think we can't equivocate respect and dignity. Because then it would almost be like we look out upon a revolt in Ferguson and say, as sometimes is said, if you haven't noticed, like some of the media say, they don't have any respect for their community. See, I think that's bullshit. That doesn't mean they, this is in the children's section, I don't think that when people say, look what they're doing, they don't have any respect for their community, I think this is extremely problematic. I mean, this can be exactly the opposite. It can be an expression, even a demand for respect. And even having self-respect may not save them from indignity. If you say people living in an impoverished community who have an opportunity structure around them that's essentially closed off, self-respect may not solve the problem of dignity. So I see self-respect and the respect of others as somehow prerequisite for dignity, but dignity is some larger thing. It's complicated. It involves other feelings and other relations with people. I think that's right.
Yeah. Society ever have everyone feel dignified, or is riot inevitable for Because if one class is dignified, then another one may not. I mean, is riot always going to happen because someone's going to feel undignified, right?
Yes, I think this is a good question. I think what I would say we want, and we, I mean, this would have to be defined, but what I want, and I think what many other people want, regardless of how they identify politically, is a world with dignity, lives with dignity, an everyday life of dignity. Now, can we ever have a world in which no one feels indignified? I think to me, probably the answer is no. It's kind of like when Marx was asked, can we ever have a classless society? Marx didn't say yes in 1897. Marx said a classless society, when Marx thought of a classless society, where there was essentially no class exploitation, it was a kind of North Star. It was a kind of, you know, it was an ideal toward which, but communism takes place far before that. It's the activity of conflict before, and you may never reach at it. Or like when Hegel said universal consciousness, he didn't think that sometime in 2020 everyone would have the same opinions. So I think that, you know, it's not a question of whether or not we can prevent any future indignity, but rather it's a question of addressing deficits of dignity where we find them, and with the body and through the body, so that these expressions of indignation communicate something to us about people in the world they live in. And this is the philosophical moment. The philosophical moment is a communicative moment about people in the world that they live in. So problems don't get solved totally. That's one piece of an answer. Another piece, which I'll just say quickly for now, is that I think that capitalism has a problem with dignity. It has a dignity problem. Crisis is not just defined in a narrow economistic sense. Crisis can also be a crisis of dignity. So, a great Italian theorist, Franco Berardi, he talks about how when the economic crisis happened in 2008, they always brought on economists on television to talk about the economic crisis, but they might have done better to bring on psychologists because the crisis wasn't simply a crisis of exchange relations in monetary terms. It was a crisis of faith, a crisis of confidence, and a crisis of precarity, that people can't have faith in a future. There's no certain future, and capitalism no longer can reassure us of that certainty. It's incapable of doing it, try as it might. It hasn't been able to solve the problem of dignity. So when you watch on the news and you see like that the Dow Jones is doing, or the stock market is going up and down, that does not map out over improvements in how people feel about their futures. So I think that dignity is a part of a bigger analysis about crisis and capital and the present state of affairs.
Question?
Sure.
Would you say that there is a vacuum in the vernacular for a differentiation of indignity which arises out of the self, or actions and feelings which arise out of the self, and indignity which arises out of the actions of other people?
Is there another part to it?
Yeah, would you like me to ask the second part?
Sure.
And can you say with any confidence that solving the problem of capital will solve the problem of dignity?
Uh-huh. Okay. So, these are good questions. I mean, I think that indignity of the self, where a person lacks self-respect, self-understanding, and doesn't feel dignified because maybe they feel very badly about themselves. I think that's not entirely unrelated to the respect and recognition of other people. I think that those things are connected. So people who've been abused, for example, I mean, this again being a kind of clinical psychological dimension, people who've been abused, for example, often express feelings of a low value of the self or unworthiness, or that somehow they are the reason for the for how they've been treated by others. So what happens, I think, sometimes is that in the face of indignities, we sometimes lose our self-respect. And it doesn't seem to me that these things are hermetically sealed off from each other. That we can define them differently, because of course sometimes a person is well-liked or loved by their peers in a community and doesn't feel that they're doing a dignified thing. And it also works the other way. Sometimes a person feels that they have a lot of self-respect, but that the police don't respect them, that they don't, that the politicians don't look upon them as humans, as the person I quoted, Tef Poe, said in Ferguson. So I think these things are different, but they're interrelated. Now, this actually gets to the third question you asked about capitalism and dignity. So the way I think about communism, I mean, this would be a whole nother evening, but just briefly, you know, I think about the word and the concept communism in a similar way as to how a French theorist, Jacques Camus, spoke. He wrote and spoke about communism using two German terms, Gemeinwesen and Gemeingeist, which we've spoken about this stuff before. But Gemeinwesen and Gemeingeist, I mean, these communism for Jacques Camus was about a different orientation. It was about Gemeinwesen, which is a essence or sense of community, the essence of the community. It was a kind of togetherness, a kind of solidarity, assigned a kind of a community of mutual respect, dignity, support, solidarity. Gemeingeist is the spirit of the community, or that doing things not just for the one person, but for the holistic health of a collective or a group of people. So I think about communism as being a kind of alternative logic to the logic of capital. It's not about private wealth, but it's rather about what Thomas Hobbes called the commonwealth. And I think that in a kind of communist orientation, or in a kind of communist logic, we would create the conditions for greater dignity, greater human solidarity, greater mutual respect coming in both directions. And one of the things that I would argue in terms of communism, I don't think it's so much about a different economic system, although that can be a part of it, but it's about a different way of thinking about ourselves in relation to others. Not exchange relations, but human relations. Not relations that are always governed by a logic of profit, but by a different logic, a communist logic. Just think about the word communist, the idea communist, that indicates something about the common, the commonality, the community. And in the book, the three principles are dignity, which I propose as a piece of this precarious communism. The one is dignity, which I read from today. The other two are autonomy and association. Now that third one, association, is very important, and it links to dignity, is that I accept a very old sociological idea, and that is that we are social beings. And when cut off from others, that is what psychoanalysts call depression, a feeling of being cut off from others. So association and a communist idea is a kind of antidote to that privatization of the self from other people. So it's not something like a silver bullet or a foolproof plan, and that's why it's precarious. The communism I recommend, the communism I think we need, and the only communism that I think can be recognized in the 21st century is a precarious one. It is one that wants to advance a different logic of life, a different way of being in the world with other people. And I think this would lead to increased association and increased dignity.
Do you find it beneficial or reflections on things that make us dignified or injustices happen in spaces or communicative mediums that separate our minds, our thoughts, ideas from our physical bodies.
So could you say what, for example?
For example, a lot of following something like Ferguson or the Arab Springs, continued discussions tend to happen, I think, you know, online or through communicative technologies where we're not face-to-face, you know, where our thoughts and ideas are occupying the same spaces as our physical bodies with other people. They're happening in spaces where those two things are separate.
Definitely. So thank you for the clarification.
So in the section of this book on association, there's a 4 or 5 page discussion of a condition in Japan called hikikomori. And hikikomori is such a strange condition, social condition, that I actually had to provide in the book citations to Japan's Department of Labor Statistics so that readers would be convinced I wasn't making it up. And what is hikikomori? Hikikomori is the Department of Labor in Japan calls it an epidemic of youth. It's that large scale a problem. And what is the problem? It's a problem of young people who create a world in which they can interact with other people just through computer screens. And they lose the ability to go outside and actually in France, the problem has spread. There are some articles that have been written about this condition in the United States. We call it shut-ins, or in France it's called I forget exactly what the term is, but they call it shut-ins, of some kind of shut-ins, where the idea is that we are creating a world without bodies, without the bodies of other people that we prefer to the real world. And now there's a generation of young people in Japan. And why does the Department of Labor analyze it as a problem? Is because they're not going out into the job market. And so you have a large number of a youth population that the government expected would go out into the world and work. But the problem is they prefer a world in which there are no other embodied people. And they've lost that sociality. And that's why it's a part of the section of my book called Association, is because I think that association also takes bodies. So, you know, you can talk to people in all these disembodied forms, Facebook and Twitter, and actually increasingly and frighteningly, the whole educational apparatus of universities is moving away from the embodied form of people in rooms talking to one another. The university I work at, no exception there, everything is being transposed into cyberspace. And I almost seem like a curmudgeonly old Luddite when I say, but the body matters for education. Well, you just don't like technology. See, I don't think that's true. I think that the interactions of bodies is an important part of our sociality. It's a part and part of association. And I do think it's hard. I do think dignity is hard in a world of disembodied brains that just conference through the internet. We like to see each other. We like to meet each other. And we like to start and engage in projects with one another that we can take up in our local communities. What is, for example, just to take it directly to your question about your specific question about a dignity in this context? What does an expression of dignity in Ferguson look like without the bodies together? Think about, what does the occupation of Tahrir Square look like if it's a conference of brains in cyberspace complaining about first Mubarak and then Morsi? What does the occupation of Taksim Park and Gezi Square in Turkey look like if it's a cybernetic complaint? The actual bodies in public space, I think it's a bit frightening that that's become an old-fashioned idea in politics. The notion that bodies in a public space is somehow old-fashioned, I think, is not just problematic for dignity, it's problematic for politics and for expressions of indignation. I don't think, in a certain sense, there's so much that is new. People like to talk about the Arab Spring with the cell phone dimension, but they all had cell phones. But I think one of the things that you see there is that no matter how many of them have cell phones, and no matter how much there is of a cybernetic dimension in communications technologies, still the old form of bodies together asserts itself. And in fact, I would say it's the only and the most assertive form of that expression. The other forms don't quite work. I think governments of the world would be very happy if expressions of disaffection only took place in the communicative space of Twitter accounts and Facebook. And for that reason alone, we should distrust it as a form. Maybe one or two more, and then we could
stop.
Because this would be a really short question. Do you think that social media, the internet, so on and so forth, a lot of younger political activists, do you think that things like Facebook, aside from bringing a collection of like-minded individuals, also perpetuates apathy towards things like Ferguson, Mike Brown, just social injustice in general? That what you were saying about this sort of disembodiment, that it does perpetuate just a, pardon my French, but an eh, fuck it,
right,
basically.
Yeah, I mean, I think that technology is now there are some theorists, mostly more on the liberal spectrum of politics, who look to technology as a solution to every problem. And then there are some theorists on a more radical spectrum who are anti-technology, and specifically in some anarchist milieus and things like that. I reject both claims. So I think that certainly it's overly optimistic on the level of a very bad utopianism to think that technology is only solving problems. I think oftentimes technology is, in the act of solving problems, creating new ones that we discover later on. You know, so like Paul Virilio, famously said that the invention of the train was also the invention of the train wreck. So it get places faster, but then you also have a whole other set of concerns and possible problems. Just so people know, really always isn't saying there should be no trains. He's just, as a kind of idea, he's saying it creates other problems we don't think about until we have them, something like that. But I also don't like the more radical view that comes out of some anarchist milieus that wants to vilify technology, and sometimes this is called a primitivist anarchist approach. Because I think, in a way, that technology has a certain kind of neutrality. It's not totally neutral because it's researched and developed for specific things. You can't just retool your cell phone into some revolutionary device. I mean, we have seen governments in Myanmar, in China, in other places who can firewall off a whole, in Iran this happened a few summers ago, that who can shut down or firewall off the cyberspace, to fence in cyberspace, not just physical space. So I don't think it's totally neutral technology, that people can just use it for whatever they like, but I do think it has its positive dimensions. And also, it has its negative dimensions. I mean, I think I probably tend toward the side of highlighting more what is damaging about it myself. I tend to think not that technology is bad. That's not my view. But I do tend to think that technology has put us on the fast track of privatization. So while everyone is talking about the privatization of public parks and public universities, we are really privatizing social life. Now we can be with other people all day and all night without ever seeing anyone or ever leaving a 4x4 room in an apartment. And I think there's something extremely dangerous about the technological tendency to keep us apart and make us feel that we're together. I think that's a problem in terms of a communist idea of coming together. It's a problem for association, and in different ways, it's a problem of dignity too. I don't know exactly that the hikikomori youth in Japan feel that they're living the best of all, the best possible lives. They're just living a life that they've become accustomed to. I think it's very problematic for social and political reasons. Let's do maybe one more. Please.
Do you have any answer to the question you posed of why there isn't more revolt? Because the majority of people are totally unsatisfied. What is the fear that keeps it from happening?
It's such a great question. I think in some ways for me, this question you asked is the overarching question of many years of thinking for me, and I still don't have an answer to it, except, you know, I think that the more I think about this question, I think it's something we all should think about. And I hope that this, as a final question, can also be taken as a kind of invitation. Why is it so far and few between moments of revolt when the conditions that revolts oppose are ongoing? It's not, for example, like impoverished black communities have just started being impoverished, right? And the opportunity structure has been closed off. It's not like Mubarak just started being bad in January of 2011. So I think this is the big question now. One of the reasons why I go into this language about feeling and affect and dignity is because it seems to me that there is a distance between a logical proposal, like you should revolt and demand something, and the actual affective state of the people. I think that the affective state of the people has to be brought to a certain point of disaffection. In a way, this is a very Marxist idea, before people will find themselves in a position where they can revolt. So, like, in Egypt, I give you two examples. In Egypt, there were fathers and mothers who'd been wanting to oppose Mubarak in the 1980s and the 1990s. And why did it happen when it happened? It's a kind of unplannable convergence of a whole set of disaffections in a generation. And they'd been trying to oppose Mubarak, but you can't just decide to make a revolt. And this is why I think the older communist idea from the previous century that we need to sort of organize uprisings is very problematic. My view now is that uprisings happen or they don't. And there's a certain inertia, and there's a certain spontaneity to them that we can't plan. I mean, when Mohamed Bouazizi in Tunisia lit himself on fire, he could have had no idea that was going to spark off a wave of revolts in North Africa. But it did. You know, it wasn't just that act, but it was a resonant act. He lit himself on fire, and a food vendor in Tunisia, and the that expression of bottomless sadness and loss of hope resonated through the society, and the generation somehow was able at that point to take it up throughout the Middle Eastern and North African countries in a way that was quite unplannable. Why people don't revolt, I think largely is because people don't revolt on the basis of a decision. It's rather some affective state, some chain of disaffection, of immiseration, that brings them to that point where they feel now is the time. And it's not satisfying because I think what we want when we look at the problems in the world, and a lot of us don't even do that, is we want to know how can we address them? And I think that all of us have to keep trying, but with a self-conscious precarity, trying in the context of admitting that we don't know. last word is, I'll give you.
This question of why don't people revolt, most people don't want to revolt by themselves. And because in order for a revolt to be at all successful, you need a bunch of people. And I think because people are so isolated from each other, they think that they're the only one that wants to revolt, or that there aren't that many people, and they really don't find out that they're wrong until it does happen spontaneously, like in Tunisia or here in Ferguson.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think this is right. I think there's one dimension of it where it really isn't as spontaneous as it looks. A lot of these seemingly spontaneous uprisings have prehistories that we could trace. In Egypt, in Ferguson, in Turkey, in Spain, wherever you like, we could look at a history there, and it has specific contents. So I think a lot of what we see is a seeming spontaneity, but I think you're right. I think that there has to be a coming together of people who share openly, in public, not privatized spaces behind computer screens, a common disaffection about the plight before them, and that these are the disaffections that make a revolt. There has to be that kind of, there's a, Raoul Van Eyckham wrote a book called The Revolution of Everyday Life, where he talks about nihilists and nihilism. And there's one line in it where he says, "Nihilists, if only you would notice that other people are also nihilists." What could come from that? That your unhappiness is not a private property, that there is a shared unhappiness in different sectors of society that, once made known, can make revolt. All right. Well, I'll stop there. Thank you so much for your time this afternoon, and your attention. Thank you.